Today in matters of fact, 28 congressmen did not vote for Representative Alan Peter Cayetano for Speaker, making them by default members of the House Minority Bloc in the 18th Congress. Now by tradition, the other nominee who lost to Cayetano will head the group. But there are also concerns that this is another case of the majority hijacking the minority, with its presumptive leader said to be quietly fielded by the Speaker himself. Now, joining us today from our Rockwell studio is Manila Representative Bienvenido Abante, who is expected to serve as minority leader. Good morning, Congressman, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Christian. Okay. Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, first, when will your assumption or appointment or election basically be formalized as House Minority Leader?
Today at 1 o'clock, we're going to have a meeting of the minority bloc that voted for me for speakership, and then we will be electing who will become the minority leader.
So you are expected, that particular election is expected to be formalized this afternoon?
Yes.
Okay, Now let's address the elephant in the room here, because we know that word is going around that you are basically a Cayetano creation, basically the majority allegedly hijacking the minority once again.
Well, you know, it remains to be seen. I think that people should just watch and see how I fiscalize. So in the 13th and 14th Congress, Cayetano was in the minority, and I was in the majority. Yet he knew for a fact that I almost stood in Congress as an independent and a fiscalizer.
But was your election supported by Speaker Cayetano?
Well, Cayetano is a friend, you know, and of course, if I may say that Cayetano would have my support, would be very good, you see, because there's no other naman minority bloc that contested the speakership yesterday.
But is it also correct to say that Cayetano fielded you to become the House Minority Leader?
Well, it would not be entirely correct. The thing is, we talked together about the speakership and everything, and I decided to be the minority floor leader. We just organized about, 3 days ago, and I called up some friends who are in the minority and block and tried to organize them.
Congressman, first I'd like to clarify, it would not be or it would be entirely correct to say that Cayetano fielded you?
No, it's not entirely correct. No,
it's not entirely correct that he fielded you?
No.
Okay.
No,
so how did you bag this this leadership position in the 18th Congress? You mentioned that this was discussed during that meeting with minority members, right?
Yeah. Well, I thought about being a fiscalizer again. So, it's a coalition anyway, and it's not a two-party system. So I decided perhaps I would be in a better position to fiscalize if I would be in the minority.
But initially, what was your preference? Were you actually at first rooting for Cayetano to become the House Speaker?
Well, the three main, let me call protagonists for the speakership talked to me personally about that. All of them are my friends. Like Martin is a good friend. He was my colleague in Congress. Alan Peter Cayetano is a very good friend of mine. And Lord Alan. And the thing is, I have not actually decided yet who I will support. And then so I thought about my position in Congress, my move to fiscalize. I would have never thought about it for a while. But then praying about it, so I said, I think it's better for me to be a fiscalizer and, you know, independent. In fact, I opted to put up a conscience block in Congress. So being an independent, no, I don't have any party at the time.
So when did you come to this decision? Was it during or after the meeting with the eventual Speaker Cayetano?
Actually, about several weeks ago, I had sat down with the three people that would like to run for the speakership. But then in my own mind, about a month ago, I decided to put up my own conscience block, starting with some independent in the House, because I run as independent and I run under a local party. So seeing that there would not be actually a formidable minority, no, except of course some LP in the Makabayan Block, knowing that the LP has already in a way joined other coalitions. So I said, I think it would be good for me to be in the minority, no, or perhaps to lead the minority. So I talked with Congressman Janet Garin, who used to be in the LP, now he is with the NP, and I said, can you join me to form the minority bloc? So and then I was told that Congressman Kip Belmonte also would like to be in the minority. So we talked together, and then later on I talked with Congressman Pido Garbin, who used to be in the minority. And then afterwards, we called on Congressman Zarate, and we had a good talk. And so we coalesced, so, just like the majority. So we coalesced and said, let's try to be together and put up a formidable and a true fiscalizer in Congress.
Okay, so you described this minority bloc that you are expected to head as a conscience bloc, right?
Yes.
But of course, others might also dismiss your bloc as a company union, similar to the minority, the official minority in the 17th Congress. How do you respond to that?
When we talked about being in the minority, I told my colleagues, okay, I told Congressman Sarate, I told Congressman Garbin with the Ako Bicol, that they are free to express whatever their advocacy is. They are free, at liberty, to to stand and whatever, you know, opposition, whatever line of thought they have in Congress. The only thing is that we ought to be united in critically collaborating together with the administration and with the majority. I would want a minority that is not just, for the purpose of opposing everything, but we would like to be a minority that would perhaps objectively, critically collaborate with the administration.
Okay, now of course, to some people, it was surprising that the Makabayan Bloc decided to join the minority. Given
say it again, please.
Okay, of course, some people were surprised that the Makabayan Bloc decided to join the House Minority Bloc in the 18th Congress, when in fact, during the previous Congress, they decided to form their so-called Independent Minority Bloc. Now, the concern is that is there some sort of a sellout here in the case of the Makabayan Bloc by joining the Conscience Bloc that you're talking about now?
No, there was no sellout. I cannot offer anything. I'm not in the position to offer anything. It's just more of a kindred mind, more of a coming together. I think this is one of the few times in the history of Congress where I was able to put up this kind of a coalition with togetherness. You know, I always said that we agree to disagree. Now, later on, for example, if the Makabayan Bloc cannot anymore in a way agree with my posture as far as objective, critical collaboration is concerned, they're always free to go, always free to leave, always free to be independent.
Now, of course, we're familiar with the Fariñas Doctrine that was used or even made as an excuse to come up with it is a so-called majority-supported or fielded minority. Now, given the fact that there were only two contenders yesterday, you and Speaker Cayetano, so I suppose you're back to tradition. The losing nominee becomes the minority leader. My question is it time to scrap this Fariñas Doctrine?
I guess it's a surprise, no, that only two contested for the speakership. The thing is this, whatever the Parinas doctrine is. And I have not actually read it yet. I have not actually, you know, been informed yet on that. But the thing is, we promise the Filipino people that we will fiscalize, we will critically collaborate with the majority, we will support the government, we will support the objectives when we know that it is for, in the interest of the Filipino people. And that would be our promise.
Okay. Now, how do you intend to deal with Congressman Ed Selagman? He decided not to vote for either you or Speaker Cayetano. He actually assailed the creation of this minority. Again, he claimed that this is a creation of the majority, or at least backed by the majority.
Well, we talked together several times. In fact, when we were creating the minority bloc, I called him up. You know, I said, Edsel, you know, you're one of the veterans, and I think it's good for you to join us. And he told me, well, you know, if you're the only one, there's no problem with me joining you, but I would like to find out who are the people in the minority. Of course, he could, we'd always have reasons to say that he is a company union. I said, why don't you join us and see what happens? Now, if later on you would really feel and think that this is a company union, then leave. They're always free to leave.
Okay. Now, were there any concessions with Speaker Cayetano, between you and Speaker Cayetano, when it comes to you being the House Minority Leader?
No, there are no concessions. There are no concessions.
How about assurances?
Whatever it is said, whatever the rules say, we are actually looking at the Congress rules right now. Whatever it says, we will abide by it.
Okay, now let's go to your legislative agenda as members of the House minority. Yesterday, the President, during his long State of the Nation address, the fourth one, one item that stood out, of course, was his call for Congress to reinstate death penalty. Your position in this?
Well, actually, Christian, no, my advocacy is more pro-life, okay?
Yeah.
But when it comes to the death penalty, I've always been supportive of the death penalty ever since I came in the 13th Congress. And everyone knows that, okay? But a death penalty only for heinous crimes, like rape, like massacre, like plunder, all of those, you see? Only on heinous crimes. All right, and not any other crimes for that matter. So I am supportive of the death penalty.
But that is your personal position, but you also have members of the minority bloc that are against the reinstatement of the death penalty.
I know. And they are free to, of course, institute what they want. And I told them we agree to disagree. I have my own advocacy that I would like to really push in Congress. You have yours. But this afternoon, one of the things we're going to talk about is our agenda as a minority bloc. Okay? Our agenda that we can agree on. And secondly, what are we going to do with some bills that, of course, I would not agree?
Like what?
Well, for example, like, of course, the Makabayan Bloc has a lot of things in mind. Okay, and I told Congressman Zarate, Congressman, I said, you are free to voice out whatever sentiments you have in the government. Okay? That would be your own personal agenda, if you want. But we are also free to voice out our own sentiments. So the thing is this, you know, for the very first time, we said, okay, let us agree to disagree. I told the members of the minority bloc, and all of them agreed.
But won't this somehow weaken your position as a minority bloc if it turns out that you have more items that you disagree on than you agree on?
Well, I don't think so. I've always, you know, Christian, I'm a man that can always stand alone on my advocacy. So if somehow, some way, in the middle of the road, that some of the minority bloc don't want me to be the majority leader anymore, fine. It's up to them.
Okay. Now, I'd like to ask you about the president's views about religion and God, because you are a senior pastor, a bishop of the Metropolitan Bible Baptist Church. Yesterday, the president in his sona said, "I am a believer of a universal mind there. I do not believe a God so perfect would create hell for his creation. What kind of God is he? He is not my God." How do you respond to this?
I don't agree with that.
Yeah.
I don't agree with that. So that would be something that the president and I would disagree on. And even if we talk together about that personally, I would tell him that.
And what would you tell him?
I would tell him that I believe in the God of the Bible. I would tell him that the God is not the author of sin. I would tell him that the sin came into this world. I would tell him that the devil is real. I would tell him that hell is real because it's in the Bible. And it takes faith to believe in it. And if he doesn't want to, it's up to him. We're always free to believe what we want to believe in.
But is there something in the president's pronouncements about religion and the God of Christians as fundamentally erroneous?
Well, of course, there is. I think that he always say this, not trying to attack all religions. I guess that because of, he said it himself, no? That when he was a young boy, something happened to him. I think he had history, as far as he is concerned, when it comes to his, disagreement with his own religious views, own religious mind.
Now, of course, the president previously justified those words about the Christian faith, not just the Catholic faith, as a freedom of expression by the president. But as a bishop, as a leader of a church group, aren't you offended with the president's position, given the fact that while we acknowledge that he has his freedom to express his opinion on anything, he is still the president, and somehow that might go against the exercise of free religion by people of faith?
When I first heard that several months ago, attacking the Catholic Church for that matter, I said, well, he's a Catholic, so perhaps he has the right to attack the Catholic Church. But then when he began to speak about God in general, in the first time I was actually offended, because I told myself, well, the president is the president, and I think that it would be better for him to be more adept in his own political policies than try to argue on religion. But I guess he has the freedom to do it. I can remember as far back, Christian, in America, where we copied our own constitution. You see, that in the first Congress in the States, many, many years back, in the 17th century, that one-third of the members of Congress then were clergymen. And some of them were Baptist preachers like me.
Yeah.
And when the Bill of Rights was instituted in America, well, some Baptist pastors were the ones that authored that. And one of that is the freedom to express our faith. Perhaps I have to blame the Baptists for putting up what we call a soul liberty on that on the term. But the thing is this, that is the essence of what democracy is, the freedom to express one's belief. And I would agree with the president. He has all the freedom to say what he would like to say on religion. He is only expressing his own constitutional freedom.
But also, as members of a particular religion, you also have the freedom or the right to be offended and not to be offended by someone who is occupying the highest position in the country.
In fact, remember many, when he was, I think about 1 or 2 years ago, he spoke about the stupid God, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I have a preaching on that. You can see it on YouTube. You know, the title is The Stupid God. And there, it tells the story on how I answered back the president.
Okay. Now, you said that you are basically pro-life, even if you are in favor of death penalty for heinous crimes. But how do you view this drug war by the president? Based on official revised numbers from the police, they say that at least 5,500 people were killed in police operations since the president took office.
Number one, I believe totally in the drug war, you know, the president has espoused. I fully support him to that. Number two, I have reservation on, of course, the killings and everything. Why? Because, you know, if big drug lords are actually, say, being killed, I won't be surprised. I might even agree with it. But when you begin to see poor people, you know, being dragged out and being killed, that I have some reservations.
Okay, finally, before I let you go, just curious, because you have at least two bishops who are members of the 18th Congress, of course, you and Brother Eddie Villanueva. Of course, you have the speaker, Alan Peter Cayetano, is very fond of quoting from the Bible. So are we expecting somehow a more behaved House of Representatives in the 18th Congress with you guys there?
Well, I believe so. Number one, I told the minority bloc, I believe that Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano would be fair. I expect him to be fair and cordial. Why? Because he makes a profession of his Christian faith and he quotes from the Bible. So I would think that Speaker Cayetano would be fair to all, whether even if we are in the minority bloc.
Okay, Congressman Benny Abante, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you for watching. Now, for more videos, subscribe to the official ANC YouTube channel and click the I button.